So I am thrilled to welcome everyone, both in the room and online, to the Mailman School of Public Health's Grand Rounds on the Future of Public Health. I'm Linda Freed. For those of you who I haven't met, I have the honor of serving as the dean at this great school, and today of opening a very important Grand Rounds. For those of you who haven't been to Grand Rounds before, the goal of our once a month Grand Rounds series is to have an intellectual gathering of all members of the school from all departments and center to consider issues that are central to the future of public health, that no matter what we work on, we should be thinking about and addressing. And this year's theme in that spirit is devoted to discussing and understanding the importance of public health as a public good. What do I mean by that? Well, public goods are essential elements of a society in which no one will make a profit, but everybody benefits, in which we are not in competition with it if once provided. So that if I can breathe clean air, it doesn't deprive you of breathing clean air, et cetera. And in which all boats get raised by the provision of this public good. I would argue that public health is an essential public good in that definition. And our public health system is the vehicle through which we deliver that public good in large measure, not solely, but in large measure in the United States. So this year we are focusing on discussing and understanding public health as a public good, and further how we should invest in this public good to more effectively create a healthy population. Our previous sessions of Grand Rounds this year have focused on translating science to practice to promote health equity. And today we will continue with this theme and discuss how foundational core and legal public health services contribute to the public good. The US public health system, as I'm sure you are all aware, is the major translational arm for the knowledge that schools of public health create as to how to improve the health of populations. And it is, of course, the US's vehicle for delivering the conditions to our population so as to be healthy. At national level, in the 50 states, territories, and tribal areas, and in over 3,000 local health departments. It operates through delivering 10 essential services to promote the health of all, which include assessing and monitoring population health, investigating, diagnosing, and addressing health hazards and their root causes. And I'm sure everybody in this room does work in one way or another on those health hazards. Communicating effectively to inform the population, strengthening, supporting, and mobilizing communities, implementing policies, plans, programs, and laws, utilizing legal and regulatory actions, enabling equitable access, building a diverse and skilled workforce, improving and innovating through evaluation, research, and quality improvement, and finally, building and maintaining a strong organizational infrastructure for public health. These services rely upon a system, a public health system, that operates, as I said, at federal, state, and local levels to efficiently promote healthy, longer lives and prevent disease, disability, and injury. Exactly are the mission we share. Our current pandemic has certainly underscored the necessity of this, as well as the importance of having public health systems that operate effectively and interoperably at these multiple levels. Simultaneously, I'm sure we're all completely aware that this pandemic has highlighted deficiencies in our public health system and in the public's health. Inadequate and inequitable investments have created major challenges over the years, and in fact, disinvestment in ensuring that public health can optimally meet the population's needs, carry out these essential services, or utilize our cutting-edge knowledge to adequately protect all populations. As a result, we saw a disproportionate burden of COVID-19 infection and mortality in underrepresented communities, particularly with pre-existing disease burdens. This trend of the pandemic reflects patterns we see beyond and before COVID, where those who are beneficiaries of more public health, healthier environments, and the right more education and the right medical care are living longer, healthier lives, longer lives with health, and have resilience to health threats. So we in public health, I think, need to ask ourselves, how can we support the public health system? How can we better support the public health system? Because it's become clear to me that if we in schools of public health do not stand up and provide the evidence as to what's needed in a public health system, advocate on that behalf, that there is a set of missing voices which are desperately needed. And we need to leverage what the work we do to translate it better into what the public health system can carry out. So to take this forward with real experts, I am thrilled that today for our conversation, we're joined by a really esteemed panel of professionals who have experience with these varying levels of public health services in the US. To introduce them, I'll introduce our moderator, Dr. Michael Sperr, our moderator for today, who is, of course, department chair and professor of health policy and management here at the Columbia Mailman School. His work has a particular emphasis on health insurance and health delivery systems for low and middle income populations across the US and around the world, and increasingly focused on the role and needs for the public health system itself. Thank you all for joining us today and welcome. And with that, I turn this over to Michael Sperr. Michael.
Thank you, Dean Fried. Let me just see, can everybody? Okay. Good, perfect. I'm Michael Sperr. I'm thrilled to have you all here, both in person and on Zoom. And I'm thrilled with the distinguished panel that we have to talk about some of the issues that Dean Fried just raised. In just a minute, I'm gonna introduce our panelists, but let me just sort of frame the conversation that we're gonna have in the following way. As Dean Fried pointed out, we ask a lot of our public health system here in the United States and globally. We ask a lot. We just came through a pandemic. We asked them to lead the pandemic response. We asked them to lead, you know, an effort to deal with obesity crises, opioid crises, climate change. We asked them to conduct restaurant inspections and septic inspections. So we ask a lot of public health. But the public health system, which Dean Fried described, that we have to deliver those services is quite decentralized, it's quite fragmented, and it's quite under-resourced. We have almost 3,000 local health departments, some of which are just tiny, you know, very, very small, others of which are very large, New York City, Marion County, et cetera, very large. Great differences in resources capacity. We have 50 state health departments, tribal health departments, territorial health departments, but those tribal and territorial and state health departments vary significantly in how they're organized and how they administer their tasks. We have a variety of federal agencies, the CDC, obviously, for sure, at the federal level. So we have all of these players. But one thing that we saw, certainly during the pandemic, although it wasn't new to us in the pandemic, was that we often say to ourselves, well, who's supposed to do what? You know, who's in charge of this? Who's in charge of that? Who should be doing this? Who should be doing that? And there's a real lack of clarity about that. We also know for sure that public health agencies face tremendous obstacles in performing their tasks. And we also know that there are some real innovations and interesting things going on out there in the public health community right now. So thinking about some issues along those lines, sort of who's responsible for what are the chief obstacles we face, what are some ideas about overcoming those obstacles, you know, those are some of the issues that I'm hoping to get into with our panel today and with all of you, both in person and online. And we're certainly going to reserve some time toward the end of the afternoon for you to have questions. So, you know, think about what you might want to ask as we're going along. Now, let me introduce our panelists. Immediately to my left here, we have Kaye Bender. Kaye is the president of the American Public Health Association. She's the former president and CEO of the Public Health Advisory Board, which accredits public health departments around the country. She's a nurse by training who spent years, many years, in the depths of the public health system in the state of Mississippi. In fact, I should have said she's still, in addition to being president of the American Public Health Association, she's also president of the Mississippi Public Health Association. She's a former dean of nursing at the University of Mississippi Nursing School, and we're thrilled to have her here with us today. Dr. Virginia Caine, next to her, is the director and chief medical officer of the Marion County Health Department in Indiana, which is largely, I don't know if it's exclusively, but at least largely the city of Indianapolis. Very large health department. In fact, the Marion County Health Department, I've learned, has more employees than the state of Indiana Health Department, the Indiana Health Department itself. You know, so it's a large, terrific organization which does work around the state. She's also a bicentennial professor at the Indiana University School of Medicine. She's a past president of the American Public Health Association, and she's a member of a really interesting and innovative public health commission that's now underway in the state of Indiana that I think we're going to get to hear about a little bit when we talk. Welcome, Dr. Caine.
Thank you. I'm a bug doctor, too. I do practice in the fourth or fifth largest public health hospital, Ashkenazi Health, in Indianapolis.
Oh, okay.
That's infectious diseases, if you didn't know.
Judy Monroe is the president and CEO of the CDC Foundation. Well, we'll probably learn a bit more about the CDC Foundation from Judy. It's essentially a nonprofit that was created by Congress to really try to mobilize private and philanthropic support, initially, I think, for the CDC, but now way beyond the CDC, you know, for public health systems across the country. Previously, she was a deputy director at the CDC. Before that, she was the health commissioner in the state of Indiana. And she's currently the co-chair of the public health commission that I mentioned a couple of minutes ago in the state of Indiana. So welcome, Kaye, Virginia, and Judy. We're really thrilled to have you here with us. True, we're really lucky. I mean, these are truly distinguished luminaries in the field of public health. So what I'm gonna do is sort of start by perhaps asking first Kaye and then Virginia and then Judy a question, but then I'm gonna have them each respond as we go along and then of course give some time to you. So Kaye, let me start with you, president of the American Public Health Association, big picture view on the public health system. I'd be like saying, who's in charge here? I mean, you know, who is sort of ultimately responsible, if anybody, you know, for paying for and delivering sort of the essential services that Dean Freed talked about a minute ago, you know, for the public health needs that we have in this country to ensure that everybody who lives in this country has access to the public health services that they need to have. You know, I mean, how does this system work?
Well, how long do we have to answer that question? So it is good to be here with you. Michael, in an ideal situation, and what you learn in your textbooks, is the public health system on the governmental side is certainly composed of the agencies you mentioned, Tim Freed, when you talk about the Department of Health and Human Services and CDC and state, local, tribal, and territorial governments. And were it that simple on the governmental side, then life would be simple to answer who's in charge. But I think what we did learn from the COVID pandemic is it gets mushy as we go through. So Lauren, let's look at this next slide, if you will. Thank you. So I don't know if you can see that or if you've been introduced to the foundational public health services. So about 10 years ago, the Institute of Medicine, the National Academy of Medicine now, put together a panel and produced a report called Investing in Public Health. And part of the intention of that report was to answer the question about who's in charge, how's it funded, how do we ensure that people who live in rural Indiana, rural Mississippi, upstate, rural New York, get access to the same basic services that people who live in Dr. Caine's jurisdiction receive. So the foundational public health services framework was developed. And then since COVID, it's been updated. So what you're looking at is a hot off the press version. But the reason I want to introduce you to that framework is you see the foundational capabilities. Those were designed and in that report to say, these are the things that the services, the programs, the activities, the responsibilities that state, local, tribal, territorial public health should be responsible for, should be consistently funded for, and they should be available everywhere for public health to work anywhere. So that was sort of, that's Dr. David Fleming's quote. Both of these ladies will remember that. Dr. David Fleming was health officer of Seattle, King County, and Washington for years, and was very committed to this notion that we have huge gaps. And of course, the gaps have only worsened since COVID. In this report, when this framework was developed, there was also a price tag attached to it and a gap analysis too. So for those of you who are interested in finance and policy, it'd be real interesting to do an updated dissertation about how well has this worked. It would be a great contribution to the field because some states, like Washington State, Oregon, some other states, Kentucky, a few other states have taken the foundational capabilities and the gap assessment tool that was actually developed by a private actuarial firm. And plugged in their numbers. And what do you think, what do you guys think happened when that happened? The financial gap was huge, huge, hundreds of millions of dollars for the health departments in those states who projected, this is what we need to work with our federal funding partners and with our state funding partners, with our local funding partners in order to provide just the basics, just foundation. Everything above the line that's called foundational services are those programs and services like maternal child health, like environmental health, some of those that are typically already funded. And it doesn't mean that they're funded well enough, but they typically have categorical funding and it differs. In a formula based on the needs. So when this was published and subsequently updated, the idea was to get the governmental public health system equal in all jurisdictions delivering the foundational capabilities. So I'll close with this part. To bring that forward to present day, there has been some conversation and some interest in the current infrastructure funds that are coming out for to strengthen public health, to actually require that health departments and their partners who put these in place report on those foundational capabilities. So to that end, and Lauren, if you'll show the next slide, then I promise to stop talking. The 10 essential public health services, I'm sure you're familiar with, been around 27 years now, was updated a couple of years ago to address equity and organizational accountability. This framework, unlike the other one, is for anybody, government, nonprofit, whomever, who practices what they call public health. The accountability mechanism in the new funding was envisioned to combine these two. And so, and I know we'll talk about this a little bit later, so I'll tease you with this a little bit. For a health department to be accredited starting in 2023, they have to address the 10 essential services, which has always been the framework, but the foundational capabilities are clearly identified and embedded. So if Congress or if the CDC Foundation or if the state legislature wanted to see how their health department was performing on those nationally agreed upon foundational capabilities, there would be a database to do.
That's really helpful and really interesting. I just want to ask Virginia, you're the director of Marion County Health Department. In Indiana, who's in charge of public health in Marion County? Is it, I don't know, because again, what I'm trying, you know, because we have this, we have federal agencies, we have state, we have local, you know, so tell us from your perspective how these issues play out.
We're a little bit different because we kind of similar a little bit to New York City. We are what's called a health and hospital corporation. So we're sort of like a quasi-government, unlike other cities where you're under the auspices of the mayor and the city of Indianapolis. Because we're quasi-government, we have function under a seven-board trustee where three are selected by the mayor, two are selected by the city council, and two are selected by county commissioners. And you can't have more than four board members of the same political party trying to make sure there's some assurances of bipartisan issues. And so I'm director of the health department, and then we have a director under our hospital setting, Ashkenazi Health. But we have two other divisions. We do run the city's ambulance services, which is sort of under the umbrella of the hospital, but a little bit separate as a division. And then we have been owners of some long-term care facilities as well.
So, but Judy, you were the state health commissioner in Indiana. I mean, when you and Virginia would talk about who's in charge, I mean, again, it's an interesting, you know, because we have this intergovernmental dynamic, in which you have federal officials, state officials, local officials.
And you want to hear her version of it?
Yeah.
I want to hear this, Judy.
I bet you do. So first of all, before I answer that question, how many years have you been health officer now in Marion County?
I was a child prodigy, folks. Okay.
All right.
So at least over 20 years.
Over 20 years. How many health officers has New York City had in the last 20 years? 20 years. That's sustainable leadership, which makes a big difference. It's because
it's
of their structure.
And it's
rare. Because it's not reliant on the mayor, right? So that's an interesting model. So yeah, so I was state health officer in Indiana for 5 years working with Dr. Caine. And I will tell you, when I became the state health officer, because Indiana's a home rule state, not all states, some states are centralized. So the state health officer's in charge, and then some are hybrid. And so they're partially in charge. And then you have the home rule where you're not in charge. And so as a state health officer, I realized really quickly that I actually did not have authority, with the exception of some emergencies. So if a local health department wasn't fulfilling certain criteria, then I would step in and I had the authority to do that. But I realized what I had influence and I needed to build relationships. And so as an example, during H1N1, we worked collaboratively.
Every day, 6 in the morning, she would call me. I'm a night person and she's an early bird person, but every day, we talked communicated at least 1 hour a day. It got to the point people thought I was working for the State Department of Health and whatever. But she's going to highlight how critical I think it is for local health departments to have great relationships with their state health departments if you're going to address an epidemic. We can't shoot each other in the foot, and we have to learn how to work effectively with each other. And each of us brings a different set of skills and influence and power by working together. And I think Indiana really showcases and highlights the incredible relationships local health departments have held with their state health departments.
I would just say, when H1N1, with the school closures, we had one of those 6 a.m. morning meetings. We were not on the same page initially. Mm-hmm. Throughout the day, we got on the same page. When we had our press release that afternoon, we were in alignment. But that took relationships and hashing it through behind closed doors. And then publicly, we were on the same page.
So in my home state, the local health departments are all entities of the state health department. So the state health department is the state health officer is the administrator for the local health departments. And there are pros and cons to that model that we could have another grand rounds about. That model is pretty typical in the Southeast. And the history there, the just brief history, goes back to when health departments in the Southeast were providers of direct care, primary care services, to fill gaps in the availability of providers. And it was expeditious and legally defensible to be able to have a physician health officer who could sign standing orders and protocols of care and that sort of thing for all of the county health departments who delivered care. As public health has changed, that model is not, my opinion, that not, there's another research project for somebody. That model is not as efficient to be able to do what Dr. Caine does in Indianapolis, and that is for the local health department to be autonomous enough to be able to respond to the needs of their community.
But I do need to make one point. Yeah. So for something, any major issue, it is under the auspices of our mayor, and we have Mayor Hodgson. And so for like our pandemic, you know, we have to look to the leadership of our mayor. He's making decisions along with the city council. And I'm sort of like the technical advisor to him related to public health issues. So we're closely tied to the hip with all the operations related to the city and carrying out any resources, any special staffing that's required. For example, don't forget your core functions, assessment, assurance, policy development. Well, I had to make the recommendations that no one COVID-19 positive should be going into a homeless shelter. So how do I put somebody in there? Some of our shelters as large as 1,000 people, I can't have them going in infecting all the people in a homeless shelter. And they said, fine, no problem. But we don't have the staff to have separate quarters from someone COVID-19. So you're going to have to be responsible for taking care of the problem. And the hospital system's overwhelmed. They said, hey, we can't keep these patients who are homeless positive in our emergency rooms for a couple of days. We got to discharge them because we got acute cases coming in. So you handle it. So I'm now in the hotel business with my staff. Okay. Do you know that a significant number of homeless, let's say 20%, have a illicit substance abuse issue? Not to talk about some of them that have a significant mental health issue. So like when one of my homeless scraped some white paint off the wall and, you know, fixed it up and we found out was dealing that white substance, though it was cocaine, he got beat up. But so how do you address this? How do you take care of clients like that if you don't have a mental health specialist? And you may not have someone in the substance abuse world knowing how to address these issues. So we got to adapt really quickly and effectively. And that's what you guys are going to have to be change agents.
So it's really interesting. I think what you've illustrated incredibly well is the complex nature of both, you know, you got the city, you got the state, you got the federal public health agencies, you have the county commissioners, the mayors, the political folks. And we saw this play out in sometimes good, sometimes not so good ways during the pandemic. But let me go back to you, Virginia, with another question, which has to do with some of the things you've been talking about in terms of you're on the front lines. I'm sure you're understaffed these days. Tell us some
that's
of the obstacles. No. I mean, that's what we want to hear about. You know, so what are, from your leadership role of trying to actually implement, you know, the public health services, deliver the health public health services, what are the main challenges? What are the obstacles that you face in delivering those services right now?
So one of our key issues was a staffing issue, okay? But let me just back up a little bit here and talk about public health revenues. Indiana ranked 45th worst in terms of receiving public health funding for the state, okay? And if you looked at 90 of our 94 local health departments, we were below the national 25th percentile in revenues brought to our local health department. So start out with that. And I'll Kaye is a wonderful nurse. So our public health nursing, we'd be down staffing from losing 18 to more than 20 nurses in terms of carrying out who's going to do the COVID-19 testing, who's going to do the immunization. So when the hospital systems were paying way more money than we're paying our public health nurses, we lost a significant number. But wow, those travel agencies came in and were hiring nurses that could work, make what they make in 6 months, what they make a whole year in a hospital system, while it went off the charts. So whether it was public health nursing staffing we were missing, whether it was licensed social workers, missing folks in epidemiology, you know, huge staffing shortages for local health departments who chronically salaries have not even been just, I just want to be close to the market. I don't have to be at the market, but get me at least close to the market. Hey, and when a hospital can give a $14,000 to $20,000 bonus to sign up, you think that's possible in my health department? I don't think so.
Hey, you were telling us earlier that in the state of Mississippi, the health department is down, what,
47%.
47%. Yeah. How do you run a health department with 47% vacancies?
Well, they've closed a lot of the local health departments because of that. Of interest, they've also contracted with the, say, the Public Health Institute in the state, which is a strong partner to the health department, to do a lot of the services. And I was sharing with Dr. Sparrow earlier, the governmental bureaucrat in me, who has spent most of my career advocating for a strong governmental state, local, tribal, territorial system, I still believe in that. But I am a little bit intrigued by some of these new models, like Dr. Caine has, where you've got a corporation, like I'm seeing as an APHA president all across the state with the COVID funds, to be able to get those out quickly. A lot of health departments couldn't get permission to spend the federal money or establish positions, much less hire them. And so they contracted the money to a third party, and like a public health institute or some other entity. And they're, at least in our state, it's not ideal. It's got some rough spots because it's a new model. Whether that kind of hybrid partnership is the wave of the future is maybe another something that you guys want to, I mean, I'm giving you dissertation and thesis ideas. Are you listening? I don't know, but it's just interesting.
So let me say, we got saved by our Indiana University Fairbanks School of Public Health. We just didn't have enough staffing with all these cases. I need to do critical contact tracing. And I had about 70 nurses trying to do it, but how could I do the contact tracing, provide immunizations or testing at the same time? So we were able to give a major contract to our Fairbanks School of Public Health for them to hire 250 employees to help do our contact tracing. They provided a lot of epidemiology support. But more important, I needed that predictive modeling analysis in order to tell me what's going to happen in a week. About how many cases am I going to have in the ER? How many respirators am I going to need? And I didn't have that level of sophistication in order to do that on my own. So there's just a tremendous potential for folks in public health to help provide that technical assistance that, you know, I didn't have time to build that type of infrastructure. So schools of public health can be really critical. All of you can provide critical elements of help that, and I know that's what made the difference for us being very successful in our outbreak.
Well, Judy, talk a little about the CDC Foundation and the role that you played during the pandemic and beyond, sort of, you know, in terms of, you have what, about 4,000 CDC fellows embedded in different health departments around the country right now, many of whom the states are having to figure out whether or not they're going to be able to afford to keep, and many of them they're not.
Yeah, no, that's right. So the CDC Foundation, first of all, was formed by Congress with the vision from four CDC directors, former CDC directors that said, we really need to forge public-private partnerships. We need a nonprofit that can be flexible, nimble. I think they designed it for COVID. I mean, quite frankly, it was formed back in the 90s. But when COVID hit, the first thing we did, we're not an endowed foundation. So the first thing we did at the foundation is we leaned in hard and fast in January of 2020. Y'all remember that month. We were out declaring as the very first foundation in the country saying, we're raising money for this novel coronavirus. And then by March, when everything hit in Seattle, New York City, funding started to flow to us. I mean, the philanthropy individuals, cause market, I mean, it was like crazy. So that positioned the foundation to be able to move with the speed at which I personally think you need to move in an emergency. So just give you an example, we were making funding decisions within 2 hours, right? We'd get the call, Richmond, Virginia calls and says, CDC calls us and says, we've got an entire Latino population about to go homeless. If we have no vaccine, it's part of the vaccine. They're in the gig economy, you know, they're driving Ubers, they're in the restaurant business, et cetera. They're about to lose their homes. They can't go to work. And I had one phone call. We also brought in like the mayor, the state, we had everybody on the call. And on that call, I said, okay, we're in, we're going to fund you. But then what you have to do is leverage the fact the CDC Foundation has come into Richmond with funding, leverage that. And they multiplied our investment by about 5 times. That. So they got a lot of money, actually, at the end of the day, no one lost their home. So that was one example. The other thing we did is we can receive cooperative agreements. And so we CDC approached us about hiring. And so that's the 4,000. We ended up hiring, and some folks are in the audience that work for the CDC Foundation. We hired field staff. And so the model was that we would do the hiring. We did all the recruiting, the vetting, et cetera. We did the benefits. They were our employees. And then we just embedded them in health departments with agreement from the health department. So the health departments, we didn't place anybody that the health departments hadn't interviewed or didn't want. But that made it really easy for the health departments, right? Because now they didn't have the personnel issues. And then we were able to now have, we embedded personnel in every state health department in the country, tribes, territories, big cities. So now suddenly the CDC Foundation, that prior to this was pretty small compared to that, we now have a national workforce, and now we've got our finger on the pulse of what's happening across the entire nation. That was an asset to CDC. So then we started having, once CDC recognized what we had built, we were having regular calls with CDC informing them about, here's what's happening on the ground that you're not going to get from any place else because we're getting a pipeline to employ.
Oh, there are these incredible, and I just want to ask the audience to start thinking about, if in about 5 minutes or so, I'm going to sort of pause and just see if any of you have questions. And I believe we have a microphone somewhere that we could take around. So just sort of raise your hand if you have a question, or maybe stand up at the side, and we'll certainly get you a mic and you know, give you an opportunity. But, you know, we could talk about obstacles. We could talk about low pay. We could talk about, you know, sort of prestige not being what it is in other fields. We could talk about sort of opposition, cultural opposition within local communities. We could talk about workforce issues more generally. How do we begin to overcome some of those obstacles? I mean, one answer is to use foundations such as CDC Foundation.
And there are public health institutes and others.
But here now we're in a situation where, according to the story in Kaiser Health News anyway, of your 4,000 employees, now that money is about to run out.
That's right.
How many of them are going to end up being hired full time, are they thinking?
Yeah, well, I mean, we don't have we think around 800 that we know of out of the 4,000. There's probably more than that because we can't track where everyone goes. So one of the innovations that is happening, one glimmer of hope here is through the ARP, the funding coming from there. There's $3 billion that just got announced yesterday. And that, the game changer there, so, and I'm going to go back to what Kaye was saying, to be able to fund the foundational public health services, about $4.5 billion per year additional is what's needed. This $3 billion is for over five years. Do the math, divide by five, that's how much per year. So it's not where we need to be. However, the difference here is this is flexible money for the health departments. And that's like unheard of. In governmental public health, there's flexibility. So when Dr. Caine gets her money, she can decide what she wants to do with that, hire staff or do something more innovative.
And that's very different from the traditional CDC funding.
Hugely different.
CDC
does categorical funding. And you know, I can just look out at the audience. All of you are not alike. You don't have the same needs. And so to restrict us when we get the funding that I've got to spend the money this way and not where I really need it, we've got to have that flexibility. And we have to have sustained funding. I don't need to know every year while I'm going grant to grant. So I don't know my expectations whether I'm going to get this grant funding or not. I mean, I need to do grants, but I need to have the level of sustainable funding high enough from local governments. But here's the problem. You got something called civil service bureaucracy. So I can only pay a nurse in, say, a local community so much money for a salary, even if I had more money and I got grant money that would pay them higher. It says you can only make this amount of money, which is very low. They haven't adjusted those governmental rates or whatever. And I hate to say it, probably 15, 20 years, okay, and guys. So it's hard to keep people when you can't pay them what they deserve and what they're valued at. And so it's like old school. This was fine with me 15, 20 years ago. So I don't see what the problem is now. It's just like, hey, we don't need to have air conditioners in schools because I didn't have it when I went to school. Yeah. So why are we paying for air conditioners for kids in school? Yeah, well, do you know they're having heat stroke? They're having clothes because the school's temperature is over 101 degrees. And do we want to stay back into 1920 or 1930 to where we were and not progressing? You know, we're progressing in medical care. Why are we not progressing in these other areas? But it's that mentality that we really have to address because people don't quite understand public health. Anybody seen Chicago Medical, ER, George Clooney? So there are a lot of, oh, and what's the guy, the good doctor, or, you know, he has this little,
we're gonna get Virginia a public health show on TV.
You can find a medical show on television left and right. But do you know of one public health show on television? So the average public understands about, hey, I'm having a heart attack, I'm going in for asthma, or I'm going for cancer treatment, but they don't always understand about public health. So that's a huge challenge for us.
So you might think if Dr. Caine were running a business, let's say she was running, I wish you were, the national public health system. And she got $4 billion. And attached to that, according to the Beaumont Foundation, we need 80,000 workers in the public governmental public health system. Why not just do it? So we've alluded to this, but I just want to put it on the table because, you know, it's my sort of pet peeve right now. And that is the influence of politics on what happens locally. So Dr. Caine just sort of started that conversation. But we've got a significant number of states around the country whose governors and therefore the state health officers pride themselves in keeping government small and their budgets low. And that includes the escalation of their budget to be able to spend these federal funds. So we've got health departments all across the country who are refusing some of this federal money because they're so committed to small government with small budgets. And that is, in my tenure of work in public health, that's always kind of been there. But it's a stronger movement across the country. Judy and Jenny, I don't know about you, but then I've seen in the whole time I've been. And so, Michael, that's one of those things that I think we also need innovations about, you know, is how do we really sort of cement the fact that the public health system is there for everybody. And it's not a matter of controlling it. It's a matter of efficiently running it and changing these 1920 attitudes.
Efficiently running it. And again, this is probably talk about politically impossible, particularly in a state like Indiana or et cetera. But do we really need 3,000 local health departments?
No.
And so what do we do about that? I mean, how do we think about, you know, making it more efficient, you know, reducing the number of local health departments? I mean, you led the public health advisory, you know, the accreditation board, excuse me. And so I think there are what, about 40 states and about 350 local health departments that right now are accredited. I looked it up right before the meeting. So, you know, it's just, I think my numbers are pretty accurate. But that's 350 local health departments out of 3,000. And I'm sure most of those local health departments could not meet the accreditation.
So 90, that's true. 90% of the local health departments in the country serve small rural areas or frontier areas. And a lot of those health departments may have half a person on Tuesday and Thursday, or maybe one person 3 days a week or something. And they typically, to Dr. Caine's point, they typically only do those services for which they get funding, categorical funding. So WIC, or maybe family planning, maybe not that now, maybe a few immunizations, and maybe a little bit of restaurant inspection kind of thing. So a companion sort of body of work to the foundational capabilities was this notion that maybe health departments that are small and rural should share services. So the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation funded this whole initiative for which, if you're interested, it's now at the Public Health National Center for Innovation, which is part of FAAN. It's called cross-jurisdictional sharing. And that, the whole idea was, you know, if you've got a half a nurse on Tuesday in the county next door, the jurisdiction to the south, you know, maybe we should get past the political turf wars and really look at what's best for the state. And I think that segues nicely into one of Indiana's recommendations.
Yeah, well, Indiana's got, what, 92 or so? Is that number right? Yeah. 92,
local 92 local counties. Wonderful counties, guys.
And it's a very home rule state.
Yes, it's very home rule, yes.
So well, tell us a little about the commission in Indiana and what some of the ideas
are. Yeah, so I think, you know, I'll speak to that as co-chair. The and one thing I do want to say, when I was at CDC, I learned this in a pretty powerful way, working with all the health departments across the country. There's a recipe for things to really happen at state or local areas. And that is where you have the elected official that has a really great relationship with the appointed health official. If they're working well together and there's enough, the health official can either influence the elected official or they're in alignment. That's a recipe for real success. So in Indiana, this current state health officer, good relationship with the governor. And so Governor Holcomb, who's in his second term as a Republican governor in Indiana, said, okay, we're going to take on public health and do it systematically. So he created the governor's public health commission under executive order in 2021. And the vision for this that we were charged, I'm co-chair, my fellow co-chair is a 25-year veteran of the state Senate, which was very smart to bring in a legislator with that. And he also is an example. He's the one that brokered the Lucas Oil Stadium in that, you know, for the Colts, right? So this guy's got some chops and he really understands Indiana. And so we were charged with studying and systematically every month we met, and the commission that was made up of local health officials, elected officials, academics, I mean, the hospital association, sat around the table and we all learned about the various aspects of what was happening, workforce, data systems, governance, funding, et cetera. At the end of the day, it was very clear on the home rule state situation. There was no way in Indiana that this commission was going to come out saying that there should be less health departments. It just wasn't going to happen because we would have lost the votes. I mean, realistically, there's no way that the commission work would have advanced. So one of the paths forward, though, was to develop, and it's something I wanted to do when I was state health officer. So I have to tell you, like, unfinished business for me, regardless of how the locals feel about it. But what the decision was for the state health department to hire district level staff. And so to reinforce the local health departments in each district, so to have the epidemiologists or the data specialists or the communication specialists, I mean, when you start looking at those foundational public health services and the capabilities, because that was the goal. The goal was the foundational public health services. And then Kentucky has done something similar, and that was through legislation as well, where they wanted to level the playing field for their local health departments, making sure that everybody in the state could have the same fundamental services, those foundational services. And then locally, though, if you want to do something more and you can financially and have the political feasibility and so forth, you can do more than that. But you need to have that floor, that, those basic services.
Jenny, do you want to add to the story there on the commission and sort of the state-local debate?
So I think the thing that you have to realize that, you know, local communities on one level, they know their communities very well. They live there. So it's so critical that they have a great relationship with their state health systems in terms of providing those essential services. But I want us not to also forget things are changing in the United States. When you look at the diversity, health equity that's taking place, that's huge. And so how do you have that community engagement with those very folks that you need to influence and assist? So it's so important to have somebody, if I'm there communicating, and it's all about the trusted messenger now. And so sometimes we can make missteps. We had 25 Latino organizations call us out, my Mira Hotstead, Joe Hotstead, and myself, to say that they didn't think we were doing enough for the COVID-19 pandemic. And I'm saying to myself, I was patting myself on the back. And I was saying, hey, I've got everything third grade language here that I'm passing out, not sixth grade, third grade, all my sites, third grade information. And then, wow, they said, hey, do you know how many undocumented new immigrants you have here, and they can't read at all? So, hey, if they're Latinos, but they can't read. So you've got to redesign your whole entire system for communications and having a separate model for those folks who can't read. So we had to have call centers with Latino speakers registering them for their testing, registering them to get their immunizations. And hey, we may have the largest Burmese communication in the country, and they speak 12 different dialects. And so unless you're doing great community engagement and you can do that community outreach and education. And so this is the beauty of partnering with folks such as the CDC Foundation. We normally do sponsorships of about $1 million, but when we can have that pot increased with like $300,000 or more to help them be our ambassadors and get that education out, it can be huge. We got a 90% rate of immunizations in our 25 to 59-year-old Latinos, over 90% received the COVID-19 immunization rate in Indianapolis. And you know why? Because we went and funded those 25 Hispanic community organizations and others from different cultures and everything to help do the education, help do the outreach, social networking, and that's huge. So it'll be less of a problem if states can do that, having that level of engagement at those local counties. Somebody can do it phenomenal, do it very well. Dean Paul Havison, he's another dean at Indiana University, did a wonderful model at Arkansas, and he worked perfectly, but he understood about the engagement from the local level. Other states may not do it as well. They may not have the same mindset for public health, like saying, hey, we're not going to accept a $4 million federal grant that you got awarded because you have one sentence in here that says you got to do some education about COVID-19. And because you have that one sentence in there, we don't want your money. So it's fine where you have less health departments, but we also got to know we've got to have the person who's got the right values understand about what we need to accomplish and are educated about the core services of public health, the 10 essential services. So if I can have that model, then I'm more fine about that. But if I have the wrong person at the helm, no, I'm not crazy about that.
Yeah.
So let me, we're running.
Sorry.
Actually, I can't believe it's almost 5:05 already. Let me just see, are there any questions that anyone in the audience has that they'd like to raise right now? Just raise your hand. There are some questions from the online people. So I'll read a question here from an anonymous attendee. And anonymous says, I'd love to hear how the speakers enlist non-public health people to be allies and advocates for public health in their communities. The words and metaphors they use,